Hello, welcome, namaste, and good evening, good afternoon, all across the world, wherever you are. Thank you so much for this amazing opportunity to be a panelist, to be a part of change-making world. All of you, my panelists, thank you so much. With folded hands, I welcome each and every one of you. I'll be your host and moderator for the evening today. My name is Dawood Waid, and off we go here. So once again, for all the listeners, the participants across the world, thank you. We are live on Facebook. We are here and we hope to engage in a lot of meaningful conversations that we're going to do today. As with the culture and tradition, we start our session with a beautiful prayer and we will take it forward after our invocation.
Namaste Sada Vatsale Matribhumi
Namaste Sada Vatsale Matribhumi
Tvaya Hindu Bhume Sukham Vardhitoham
Tvaya Hindu Bhume Sukham Vardhitoham
Mahamangale Punya Bhume Vadarthe
Mahamangale Punya Bhume Vadarthe
Patatve Shakayo Shakti Man Hindu Rashtrang Bhuta
Prabho Shakti Man Hindu Rashtrang Bhuta
Ime Sadaram Tvam Namamo Vayam
Ime Sadaram Tvam Namamo Vayam
Tvadiyaya Karyaya Baddha Katiyam
Tvadiyaya Karyaya Baddha Katiyam
Shubhamashi Shande Shaktim
Ajayyaj Vishvasya Dehish Shaktim
Sushilam Jagatyen Namram Bhavet
Sushilam Jagatyen Namram Bhavet
Shrutam Chevayat Kantaka Kirna Margam
Shrutam Chevayat Kantaka Kirna Margam
Swayam Swikratam Nah Sugam Kariye
That is so powerful, that is so meaningful. And I always have believed that your faith in God is as powerful. Your God is as powerful as your faith in Him. And what better time to, you know, invoke all the faith, because today is the time when the world has shook. A little virus has perhaps shaken the world, but also brought us together. Thomas Friedman, in his book, The World is Flat, says that indeed, today we are living in no better and no flatter world than ever before. I mean, you have panelists from across the globe, different time zones, timelines, demographics, and yet the best thing is I do not need visa to go across and meet all of you. So once again, on behalf of the amazing Charles Walser Society for Innovation Research, CWSIR, I welcome all of you. A society meant for innovation research, founded in 2019 in Uttar Pradesh, India, and it has just been leading and growing. Who better to be the first addressee of the day than the General Secretary of CWSIR, Dr. Shruti Marawaha. Dr. Shruti, thank you so much and welcome to this August panel.
Thank you, Mr. Wade. Thank you so much. Good evening,
Dr.
everyone.
Shruti, right. Dr. Shruti, thank you so much. And a quick question, you know, before you begin your session, how is the vision of CWSIR globally so big? Where did you conceptualize? How did it start?
A very good question, and a question very meaningful that has a meaning in today's society. See, CWSIR has a very broad vision, and the vision is not only on papers. We are meant to achieve it, and I'm sure with the passage of these 2 days of World Youth Summit, everyone would have realized that we are achieving the mission. We are trying to focus our energy and channelize youth synergy, helping them, assisting them to realize their own potentials. So I am sure everyone over here would agree that we are working dedicatedly towards youth development, which is the future of our nation.
Thank you so much, Dr. Shruti, and we can go ahead. Wonderful vision.
Right. Thank you so much for giving me a chance to officially open the Matu program open. A very good evening to everyone, ladies and gentlemen. I'm glad to welcome you all on the third day of World Youth Summit, organized by Charles Walter Society for Innovation and Research under the supervision of Dr. Smita Tiwari, founder of CWSIR. Unmatchable mentorship of Dr. Abhishek Pandey, whose vision and mission have inspired masses around the world. Carrying forward the learning of 2 days of World Summit, we accept the challenge of youth channelization. We accept the challenge, and that is a revolutionary step that would trigger a bent of scientific and research-based learning approach among youngsters. Conducive environment, positive de-learning, which is very important, and learning that would enable our youth to explore their own potential. Every young mind has potential. What is needed is to unlock that potential, and no one else can do that. We can just motivate them and encourage them to unlock their own potential. Let's cater to our youth. Let's not delay that, and let's understand them and try to assist our youth to unlock their own potential. So, marking the program officially open, I request Mr. Ved to take the program ahead with great luck to everyone.
Thank you so much, ma'am, and thank you for your opening remarks. We actually are really, you know, this is a joke I was dying to say, that we are an August company in July itself, and I think what better than telling it now. How about taking you to one of the most beautiful, delightful place, perhaps everyone will be looking forward, Maldives, some of the most beautiful islands in the world, and it's an honor and privilege to welcome Dr. Abdullah Raseed, the Minister of State Education, Maldives. Sir, my first, I just want to engage with everybody. I grew up in Andaman and Nicobar, some of the most beautiful part of India. Sir, how does it feel to grow up in an island the world envies?
Thank you, Mr. Dawood. It's a pleasure. It's a blessing living in a nation like Maldives. As you know, everyone in the world, Maldives is the dream destination. Then, of course, where I'm born and brought up here. So I believe that it's a blessing to be a Maldivian.
Sir, I can see the pride, the way we take as Indians, I see your pride, the way you take as Maldivian. So the floor is yours. Please go ahead with your presentation, sir.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Let me share my screen. I have a short presentation.
Sure, sir.
First of all, I can see very high level and really difficult to call them by the names. So everyone together, with all due respect, I greet you all. Assalamu alaikum and very good evening. I can see my friend, Dr. Priyadarshi, Nayak, and other high-level dignitaries. Once again, very good evening. I'm going to talk about need for revolutionary rebirth of formal and non-formal education channels. I can say this is a very important topic because transforming educational opportunities are very important. Need of revolutionary rebirth of formal and non-formal channel. I'm very happy to see this theme from this World Youth Summit, because this should be the priority of the governments, policymakers, and educational leaders around the world. Revolutionary changes are required the way we provide education to youth and children. As we can see in other sectors, things have been changed a lot, whether it is medical field, engineering field, or transportation. We can see a lot of innovation and creativity when we compare the development and revolutionary change in educational sector. We can't see that much change when compared to other industries. So transformational change are really required to empower and to develop our youth to lead and live in 21st century. When we are talking about this 21st century, skills are very important. I really love the concept of 21st century skills. When we revolutionize education for the youth and kids, we have to focus these 21st century skills. You can see the broad categories of foundational literacies. The way we define literacy in 20th century and the way we define in literacy in 21st century is different. Before this century, literacy just means basic reading and writing. But in 21st century, literacy includes scientific literacy, ICT literacy, financial literacy, cultural and civic literacy. And I believe that very soon, space literacy will also will be at the list. Therefore, we need to provide our youth and our children education in this context with these specializations. And 21st century skills include competencies, which are very important for our youth to be successful in this knowledge economy. So critical thinking and problem solving, creativity, communication, and collaboration are very important. Through traditional way of teaching, through traditional way of lecturing, it is impossible to be our young people creative and innovative entrepreneurs. Therefore, if we really want to make them or prepare them 21st century, as I said before, we have to change the way we teach, the way we lecture. And our young people should be inculcated with these qualities: curiosity, initiative, persistence, and adaptability. We are living in a turbulent world. Things are changing. Now we are experiencing COVID-19 and everything changed. So if our young people are adaptable, then they will not struggle, they will not suffer when things change. And leadership, of course, very important. Therefore, I request to change our teaching learning method by using the scientific method of teaching. When we use scientific method of teaching, the lesson should not start with just a topic or lesson 1, 2, 3. The lesson should be started with a question. The lesson should be started with a question. Then students will form hypothesis to answer the question. Then they will read whether they are textbook or other websites, or they will interview with the people. They will collect information. Then they will do the experiment to find the answer to these questions. Then they will analyze the data and they will see whether their answer is correct or their hypothesis is right. If their hypothesis is not right, again, they go back and they change their hypothesis. Again, they collect data and they do the experiment. Once their hypothesis is right, then they will write the final report. This is how teaching learning should be. I believe, in my perception, even higher education in universities, rather than teaching individual modules, we better give them projects, teach them scientifically. Then it will be more meaningful. Because when we teach just lecture method, rote learning, memorizing without understanding, traditional way of testing, these vague school university graduates, they are not really ready for the workforce. I can say they are semi-finished products. That is why they are unable to apply what they learn. And another model or another revolution I suggest is engineering method of teaching. As you can see, engineering method starts defining a problem. So students will be working and solving a problem, not just seeking for the fact or knowledge. to define the problem, after defining the problem, they do the background research, they specify a requirement, they brainstorm and evaluate to a solution, then they develop a prototype. If prototype is successful, then they go for commercialization. If prototype is not successful, then again, they have to specify, they have to revise their requirements. They have to change again, they do the prototype. At last, regarding non-formal education, in my perception, non-formal education also should be provided with creativity and innovation. And it should be flexible, very much flexible, and it should be easily accessible. It should be relevant to the youth, and it should facilitate for lifelong learning. So that's all I want to share with all the dignitaries I know, and I can see very experienced educators in this platform. I'm really excited to listen their insights. So I'm not going to take much time. Thank you, everyone, for giving me this opportunity to say a few words in this World Youth Summit. I wish everyone a very good day. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Dr. Abdullah Rashid, the Minister of Education, Maldives. Amazing, sir. You just put the opening perspective so well. And what better way to take it forward than my inviting Major Harsh Kumar, Secretary, NCERT. Sir, welcome, sir. And thank you so much for being on the panel.
सभी को नमस्कार
आपको भी
माँ सरस्वती को प्रणाम करते हुए माँ भारती के चरणों में वंदना करते हुए मैं इस सभा में उपस्थित समस्त सुधीजन को प्रणाम करता हूँ अभिनंदन करता हूँ माननीय डॉक्टर अब्दुल्ला रशीद जी डॉक्टर प्रियदर्शी नायक जी शिवप्रसाद जी बीएम गांधी जी डॉक्टर धीरज मल्होत्रा जी डॉक्टर रवि त्रिपाठी जी डॉक्टर अभिषेक पांडे जी और अन्य उपस्थित सभी सुधीजनों को मेरा प्रणाम अ वेरी गुड इवनिंग टू ऑल ऑफ यू एंड इट इज अ वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग यू नो डिस्कशन विच इज गोइंग ऑन एंड विच इज वेरी मच रिक्वायर्ड फॉर टुडेज यूथ टू अंडरस्टैंड द सिचुएशन लाइक सर हैज ऑलरेडी टोल्ड अबाउट यू नो द पोटेंशियल ऑफ अंडरस्टैंडिंग And you know what should be the way of teaching, and what should be the youth be taught. Let me tell you, you know, in our culture, in culture of the country, obviously now we it is since time immemorial that we take Vasudhaiv Kutumbakam, that the entire world is you know our brothers and sisters. We are family, so we teach, we take something. From you, we give something to you. But in the present scenario, the situation which has arisen and which the youth must understand one very important thing, and that is empathy. In this time of testing, you know, it is not the government which has come, it is the society which has come up with innovative ways and methods. And the youth have to go back to the basics. What sir was telling, you know, I could just visualize that what I have, you know, undergone in my army training, in my army days, and in the practice, what we used to do, mansa, vachana, karmana, what we think, we should speak the same and we should act as per that only. Our action should coordinate with our thought process. And how our thought process can be improved, this is what we are being taught from the childhood. Like I say every time that the aim of education is to become a good human being. Until and unless you are a good human being, it is immaterial what you are doing. You should stand with the people, sense of humanity. And that is what the essence is, you know, what we say, ki humare yahan char ved hain aur chhe shastra hain. Lekin unka saar kya hai? Dukh deen hai, dukh hot hai, aur sukh deen hai, sukh hot. And that what you call, you know, you reap as you sow. So in the foundational learning, a child, and this is, you know, what is the vision of our leadership that they have thought of this in the new education policy, the main emphasis is being given on early childhood care and education, that how a child should be taught in early years so that we make him ready to face the society. And, we are going to discuss on these things. Before that, I wanted to tell you that yesterday was a very auspicious occasion for NCERT, in which the Honorable Prime Minister, he launched Vidya Pravesh. This was launched yesterday, which NCERT has prepared, in which this module to teach a child for pre-learning from 3 years till he goes to the class first. So there's a module which has been given. And in this, I am connecting this, how this can contribute to personal and professional development of young people, right from the childhood when they come, because in this testing time, the child who is going to the school, hey, they have not gone physically to the school. They are learning online. They are missing the social gathering or the things which they adapt from their classmates, their teachers, from face to face learning. The online education, what sir was telling right now, that all this problem solving skills, critical thinking, this can never come from books only. This comes from the interaction and the practice. So how we can teach that? Now, like I said initially, that empathy. Now, how that empathy has to be developed in young persons, it is given in our, it has been very well elucidated in the new education policy regarding the umbrella policy, in which schools and universities, they have to adopt smaller schools, the villages and the areas nearby in which there are less privileged children or young people who are there, who have got less resources. So we have to support them with resources. And when this is an art of giving. When you learn the art of giving, it not only gives you inner pleasure, but it gives a chance to the underprivileged students or the people to develop with you. And until and unless everybody develops, because we all are talking on the same point, that how this can be, how the goodness can be spread. And the first thing is goodness can be spread through education only, until and unless the understanding level of each one of us is one. Like-minded people are sitting here, and I thank Dr. Priyadarshini Nayak to continuously giving me chance to present my views in the August meetings, in the seminars, in the webinars, where we can understand each other and where we can tell that what is the the goodness which is being followed at one place, so that it can spread everywhere. So in my opinion, personal and professional development of young people can be made through art of giving, first thing. And then you can train them, on IT, maybe on any aspect which one wants to teach. And for that, teacher training is very important. On that aspect, government has given a lot of stress, and in our NCERT, we have got 6 regional institutes in which pre-service teacher training is given. And now we are using massive, this digital programs in this online classes are being run, online tests are being conducted, innovative methods have been adopted. And not only for the students studying at our regional institutes, but also massive online courses for all the youths, and they can avail this facility because that is available on the website, and regular classes are being run online. Then the other courses are also being run online. It has to be disseminated to the youth that these are the courses, and they can involve themselves in all type of training which are available throughout the world also. Now, so many online courses are available, we can make small groups in which these youths can be guided for that, for the digital learning and the use of gadgets, and also to impart them to the underprivileged children of their locality. And now the government is very, yesterday also we were talking that how, you know, we can reach to the farthest villages. Government is very serious about that. And, you know, lines are being laid to the farthest villages where internet, the right now the shortcoming is that we don't have connectivity to those distant places, but we are sure that we'll overcome with that. And in future, we know that we are going for blended form of education. So the youth have to, you know, adapt themselves to the situation. And that is when you have to learn the new skills, what we have seen in these 2 years. And I pray to God that we don't see such worst years in our life and in the times to come. But then we have to be ready. Since we have seen the worst, we have to be ready for these situations. But nevertheless, we have to understand the importance of basic things like environment. You see how, you know, along with this pandemic, how this environment is going, the situation of environment is going from bad to worse. In everyday news, you see the rainfall, which used to occur for the entire year, that has occurred in 2 days, whether it is in China, in Europe, in India. So this thing has to be understood very clearly. That has been given in sustainable goals also. But we have to teach these things because youth is our future. Youth is the future of the world. And they have to understand that first of all, humanity has to exist on ground. Then only we can develop. Then only we can, you know, advance technologically. Then we only we can learn the technology or other things. But then first of all, environment, we have to understand about that. We have to understand our surroundings. Why these so many clashes around the world? You know, and in the spurts, you see so many clashes. Why? Because the thought process is not one. We have not been able to develop the empathy. So we, all the educationists talk about IQ, EQ, SQ now, but we have to pay emphasis on emotional quotient, on spiritual quotient, so that we can, you know, move ahead. I think I have crossed my time. I am crossing my time. So with these words, I end, and I thank you again, sir, for giving me this opportunity. And it was wonderful to hear, and it will be treat to hear other speakers also. With these words, I close my address. Jai Hind, Jai Bharat.
Harishji, thank you so much. Sir, bachpan se NCERT kitabe padke aate hain. So when to hear, I am as if, you know, we just celebrated Guru Purnima a week back. To hear you was so liberating, sir. So thank you so much. Ek chota sa sawal, sir, aapke liye. You have been in army. Ab aap education mein hai, and I'm just keeping to English for all the audience. Sir, the discipline that we've seen, how is the difference between the discipline in 80s children, sir, and today's children? Sir, hum zyada achhe the ki hamare bachche zyada achhe?
सर ये तो आपके सिखाने पे डिपेंड करता है, ये तो एनवायरनमेंट पे डिपेंड करता है कि हाउ वी टीच देम एंड हाउ वी टीच देम विद द यू नो आर ट्रेडिशन. और हमारे यहाँ देखिए छोटी छोटी चीजें हैं जिसको कि अगर आप देखेंगे कि जैसे आप छोटी सी चीज मैंने जैसे आपको बोली जो हमारे वेदों में लिखा है वसुधैव कुटुंबकम, दैट वी टेक द इंटायर वर्ल्ड एज आर फैमिली. यू नो अभी मैंने आपसे जैसे बोला कि हमारे यहाँ 4 वेद हैं और 6 शास्त्र हैं, लेकिन इनका सार यही है कि आप जैसा देंगे वैसा पाएंगे. एंड इट इज फॉर ऑल द मेथड्स ऑफ प्रेइंग, यू नो गॉड इज वन दैट एवरीबडी अंडरस्टैंड्स, बट देन दैट आर्ट ऑफ गिविंग एंड टू अंडरस्टैंड द अदर पीपल इन देयर पर्सपेक्टिव इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट. यू डोंट अंडरस्टैंड द अदर पीपल इन योर पर्सपेक्टिव, you understand in their perspective, and then we can understand. And then paancho ungliyan barabar nahi hoti sir, but then when they come together, then only they make a fist. And discipline is inculcated from home. You know, how do we behave with our children and how do we teach them, that is what they learn. And you know, one, it is not that they learn in school. School is one chapter of that book. So I think discipline is very important. Without discipline, we cannot achieve or attain anything in life. That is very clear. And whatever, you know, educationist, since you have said this, I will say all these things. I have jotted down what Abdullah sir was saying, that whether it is critical thinking, problem solving, creativity, commitment, collaboration, curiosity, initiative. In army, we follow this every day. In every operation, you have to take initiative. You have to be curious that what is going to happen. You don't know what is there in ahead. And you have to lead people. Then you have to understand your people. Like he was saying that, you know, you have question, the way of method he was telling about teaching, that question, hypothesis, experiment, data analysis, that thing is done in spurt of time. In seconds, you have to analyze the situation. You have to know your men. You have to know your task. Then only you can proceed further. So that is come along with the training, you know. And I think when you have added this, I think that training of NCC, training of Scout, training of NSS, training of all these things are very much required today. And in today's environment, it is inescapable. Wonderful, so these all things should be done.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much. As they say, once an army man, always an army man. Know your men. I'll remember that, sir. With that note, I would really, it was so wonderful to hear people. Let me invite our next speaker on the panel, Dr. Brij M. Gandhi, former advisor, Ministry of Science and Technology. Sir, thank you so much. And please welcome and look forward to hearing your address, sir.
I always have some problem like that. Thank you very much. First of all, I would like to thank CWSIR for inviting me to be talking to people. I'd like to share some slides which I have prepared. If you allow me, I can.
Sure, sir. Please go ahead, sir.
The topic given to me is the contribution to personal and professional development of young people. Yeah, certainly, you know, I have been a technocrat, so I have been supporting programs for development and, you know, research and development. In fact, let me see if I can.
So you can just go ahead, sir. You can make it full screen. I'll help you with it. So you can click where there's 80%. Can you go down, please, sir? Yeah, just go down, sir. So keep going down further, sir. No, sir. So just take your cursor.
We had people working for us now.
I know, sir. Sir, please call the millennials in your house. They are the ones who know technology in and out. So you can call your granddaughter.
So you can press F5.
Right. Development, we have already identified the 5 C's, which is competence, confidence. Yeah.
You can tell him to press F5. Slide
Brit, sir, just press F5 on your laptop, sir, and then the screen will be larger. On your keyboard, sir, just press F5. F5, sir. On top, right on top, sir. Okay. Done, sir. Absolutely. Dheeraj, sir, thank you so much.
In fact, broad consideration for practicing youth development, I would say, is a coordinated community level effort that ensures all youth have the equal access to array of services, support, and opportunities they need. Interrelation of services, support, and opportunities is a must. Framework is founded on community-wide mobilization and involvement. And a youth servicing program may change lives of youth to ensure focused, positive outcome that includes inclusiveness, youth voice, longevity, community involvement, and cross-sector agency. institution and program collaboration. See, when we talk of youth development of young people may go beyond skill training or finding opportunities to work abroad. Actual development should access how they use their skill in positive way, to bring in change in self, their colleagues, community, and the development of the country as a whole. When we youth development, it would look into strengthening the existing services and programs that expands opportunities, support, and resources from community to young people to develop their full potential. Promoting positive youth outcomes entails emphasis on positive outcomes, youth-wise strategies aims to involve all youth, long-term involvement of youth, community involvement, and emphasis on collaboration. Meeting the goals of youth development, there need to be perspective changes we would be expecting. There should be a change in attitude, passion and positive attitude towards working and accepting the challenges towards positive thinking. Innovation. It should be focused state-of-the-art experiment approach they are presenting. One has to question self, the rationale behind suggested approach. What is the innovative part? I would say uniqueness should be the strength of the proposed research. Opportunities, you have to look in for continuous search for the opportunities around the areas of expertise. National and state governments provide ample opportunities, support programs to develop skills in the youth. To me, safety and security, after the COVID-19 also becomes very important. Appropriately trained in handling hazardous materials may transform youth in development of clean and healthy environment safe from biologicals and chemicals. Promoting intellectual development in youth need to harness their skills in areas of expertise, assessment of their basic academic critical thinking and problem solving aspirations. They need to be involved in programs that provide opportunities to do research, tutorials, support, community projects, including systematic problem solving components of to promote independence. We should take youth as facilitators of value formation and development. Professionals are already engaged in the development process of changing lives and values of young co-workers with limited resources, supports, and infrastructure. We need to explore further the potential of these professionals as facilitators through education and training of value formation within the larger frame of youth development. At international level, many agencies and experts have analyzed issues faced by the youth based on age, gender, and diversity of displaced youth, refugees, and internally displaced people. Policy guidelines and strategies are already in place to develop institutional infrastructure and approaches to identify and respond to the needs of displaced youth and their current funding programs, monitoring and evaluation process. At national level, I'll say in India, the Department of Youth and Affairs and Supports under the Government Ministry of Youth Affairs and Supports functions largely as a facilitator of youth building. It's a Nehru Yuva Kendra, integrates power of youth on principles of volunteerism, self-help and community participation avenues towards nation building and develop their personality and skills. Rajiv Gandhi National Institute of Youth Development offers academic programs at PG levels, R&D, and coordinates training program, including gender studies, development studies, local governance, social innovation, and entrepreneur and social sciences. Department also facilitates international interaction with the international agencies or organizational joint events, participation in UN programs, and international exchange of youth delegation to create international perspective towards global development activities. See, science and technology, I've been in the science and technology department. Science and technology support system in India comes from central government and S&T departments, independent research institutions, national laboratories under S&T department and DRDO, central socioeconomic and other ministries, in-house R&D units, CROs, CMOs in private sector, state government, state S&T department, and NGOs. Funding for the science and technology comes mainly from the Ministry of Science and Technology through its three departments, Department of Science and Technology, Department of Scientific and Industrial Research, and Department of Biotechnology. Department of Health Research also supports programs in health areas through Indian Council of Medical Research. There are other departments of the government, which like Atomic Energy, Ocean Development, Environment and Forest, University Grant Commission, or Information Technology, they also support R&D programs. For all those who do not know, Department Science and Technology Ministry has three departments: Department of Science and Technology, Department of Scientific and Industrial Research, Department of Biotechnology. Department of Science and Technology basically involved with research in all aspects of science and technology, has 20 autonomous institutions and 2 statutory boards which provide funding. Department of Scientific and Industrial Research, its autonomous body, Council of Scientific and Industrial Research, has 43 laboratories supporting research in the areas of biological and non-biological sciences. Department of Biotechnology has 16 autonomous institutions. It has a mandate to work on product and process development. It has 16 autonomous institutions in specialized areas and 3 PSUs. 1 Biotechnology Industry Research Assistant Council, what we call as BIRAC, is a major conduit for supporting programs related to the industry. There are special services to the young scientists. It's the fast track research grants, rapid travel grants, small science meeting, career development awards, short and long-term fellowships in foreign labs, overseas training fellowships, associateship for specialized training in niche areas, and international research program. Also, these ministries, Science and Technology Ministry follows, provides a lot of fellowship opportunities for young under them.
Absolutely, sir. So there's a lot of questions. I think I'm getting on private message a bit, sir. So much of research that is going on. I wanted to, you know, sir, interject and just ask this question to you, if I'm allowed to, sir.
Please.
How do you develop a scientific temper in today's children? Sir, and you've seen generations, sir. So who were you, sir, as a student? Very mischievous, very obedient. Sir, can we have some honest answers from you? I can see my co-panelist smiling.
It's
curious.
It's basically the attitude. Are your, you know, thrust to have intellectual. Once you have raised this question, let me give my own example.
Right,
I worked in the Institute of Medical Sciences in the year 70s. There was nothing was available. No facilities was available. We were doing primitive technologies. We were doing primitive technologies, to run out that. There, you know, I was lucky to have the opportunities to visit MIT and, you know, London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine. I wanted to develop something for the country. So I developed hepatitis B surface antigen test at the cost of ₹1.45 against the ₹45. We were paying against the against 45 rupees, test from the Abbott Laboratories. And, you know, I further developed, brought down the cost to half. And believe me, every day we were running about 100 to 200 samples. And this technique was used in AIMS till 2005. So you can imagine in 20, 25 years, Now, how much money we saved by, you know, just manipulating and looking at what, you know, because we wanted to develop that, we developed those. And it's not that. We developed so many tests, you know, for antibody testing, all these, you know, dot assays, you know, what we call these days, you know, small, right, quick assays test. We developed at that time. My exposure to MIT USA, I brought down the, you know, technology of lipoprotein quantification. We in 1976 we did the lipoprotein quantification in the country, and that tested in the end, you know.
Thank you so much, sir. Absolutely.
You know, what if you want to achieve something, it's possible. You have to change your attitude towards yoga.
Sir, there's so much of wealth of knowledge that you bring just from the travels that you've done. Brij sir, thank you so much for sharing the amazing research that is happening. I think they always say you stand on the shoulders of the giants. So you all are the giants that the generation ahead is standing on, sir. So once again, sir, thank you so much.
I would just take 1 second.
Please, sir.
Because my last slide, if you allow me, I'll just can I go back to the slide?
Yes, sir. Please go ahead, sir. Just slide share, and you can go ahead. Just click on share screen, sir.
Yes.
Okay. A minute with Dr. Brij, and then we'll invite our next panelist, Dr. Shivprasad, to join us. So please go ahead.
Sorry, I'm not able to bring it down. See, basically...
Sir, just go next, sir. Just click on next. Enter. Just click on enter, sir.
Okay. I'm sorry. No, this is very important for me. You know, it's the biosafety and biosecurity aspect is an important aspect of youth development. The dual use research in life sciences raises concern for biosafety and biosecurity, as generated knowledge, information, products or technologies could be misused to pose significant threat that has broad potential consequences to public health, safety, agriculture, animal, environment, material and national security. Government has already constituted number of competent authorities to oversee the biosafety aspect. I would say youth can play a major role in developing bioclean, what we call bioswitch environment, by abiding to ethical principles and values of biosafety measures to protect against technologies having potential to be misused to threaten public health, environment, industry. Now, here again, I'll just take a second to say, you know, if you go to a physician lab, a physician, he asks you to get your hemoglobin done. You give the sample to them. They test for hemoglobin, and where did the other sample go? Does anybody know what was there in the sample? Was that infectious or not? They need to see that this is properly managed. There has to be risk management, you know.
Right, absolutely.
So government has to look in for that. They have to increase awareness of biosafety, biothreat identification. Training programs should be there. There should be effective monitoring system. And there should be a training curriculum for bio-based management, because then only you can make it safe. They have to, at this stage itself, in lab itself, they have to consider all these things. Thank you, Arun, right, sir, giving me.
Thank you so much, sir. There's so much to learn from each one of you for the paucity of time. You know, the worst thing that the moderator has to do is intervene. But thank you so much for sharing such level of expertise at multiple levels, sir. What I'll do immediately is I'll invite my next speaker, Dr. Shivprasad M. Khened, former director, Nehru Science Center, Maharashtra. Thank you so much, sir. And Dr. Shivprasad, you know, sir, I grew up in Andamans. Every once in a year, we would come down to Mumbai, and our go-to place was the Nehru Science Center. I, you know, one of the things I dream is my daughters also enjoy the same thing. So the floor is yours. Thank you so much for being on the panel.
Thank you so much, Mr. Dawood. You've been a wonderful host, introducing every speaker. On the occasion of this World Youth Summit, which is being organized by Charles Walters Society for Innovation and Research, It's a great honor for me to be, you know, sharing the dais with all the distinguished guests, both from India and abroad. I think the tone for the World Youth Summit for today's program was beautifully contextualized and put in place by the Hon’ble Minister, Mr. Abdul Raseed, Minister of State for Education, Maldives. You know, he talked about the concept of scientific teaching and analytical thinking in terms of engineering, the putting to use this the concepts of science and technology for formal and non-formal education. And of course, Dr. Brij Mohan Gandhiji has actually elaborated in detail the kind of opportunities that exist for science and technology research in India. I mean, across the board, cutting across from, you know, DBT to DST and all these things. What I will be speaking is, you know, this is the millennial. You, I think, use the word millennial. Those people who are all born, I think, most of the youths are now, you know, a millennial or maybe 3-4 years born before the dawn of this century. One thing that I wanted to talk to all these youths is that we are now living in what is called as a knowledge society, which people talked about. This is an age where knowledge matters. It's also an age where perhaps, you know, most of the people should grow up as job providers rather than job seekers. You know, when you are empowered with knowledge, you can apply this knowledge to entrepreneurial use, where instead of you seeking for the job, perhaps you can actually create hundreds and thousands of jobs. In order to be successful in this, more so when, you know, the Charles Water Society, when you specialize in research and innovation, talking about science, technology, research and innovation, we must prepare our youth also for failures. Unfortunately, what happens is, you know, we always tend to eulogize successes. We hardly ever talk about the failures. Failures are an integral part of any science, technology, or any success. So what I'll be doing is, I'll be talking about some of the failures that the greatest of people, the greatest of scientists, the greatest of technologists have faced in their life, so that these people become an inspiration to our youth. And so these youth are not afraid of any failure. Most of the times in the modern world, what we tell is, we tell our students, we tell our youth to think out of the box. What do you mean by thinking out of the box? Thinking out of the box means you are basically trying, you are asked to tread a path which is less treaded. That means you got to find your own ways, some new ways. When you are trying to explore new ways, there is a possibility for failure. Now, speaking about failure, let me talk to you, let me remind our youth that Lord Kelvin, you know, the greatest of, we now measure one of the temperatures by Kelvin. You know, Lord Kelvin, he was the president of the Royal Society. In the year 1895, he said, any machine heavier than air cannot fly. I'm talking about 1895. He was the president of the Royal Society. He made this statement. This statement was followed by another gentleman by name Dr. Newcomb, who also actually ridiculed Langley's achievement of space flight. Then what happens? In just 8 years from 1895, when Lord Kelvin made this statement that heavier than air objects cannot fly, here comes two youth, the Wright brothers, who were actually working in a cycle factory, cycle mechanic. They were basically mechanic. They adopted the methods which the Hon’ble Minister Abdul Rashid Ji talked about, the scientific methods of observation, experimentation, forming an hypothesis, and then they come out. In just 8 years from the monumental statement, a blunder statement that Lord Kelvin made, in 8 years, they succeed. And then we have in 1903, the Wright brothers flew for 57 seconds. Initially, of course, in the fifth or sixth attempt, then the rest is history. Where are we now? From that 1903 powered flight, where are we? Think about this. It all started from one Lord Kelvin. So when Lord Kelvin could go wrong, and he was proved wrong by none other than formally educated two youths, the Wright brothers. So this is an opportunity in this world of knowledge society, which we are also calling it as, we also call it as a fourth industrial revolution. This is a lesson for us. Similarly, I would also like to talk about a couple of other, particularly in India, most of the youth and also the children are very fond of our former president, Dr. Abdul Kalam. Everyone talks about he is called as a missile man. I mean, he was working in ISRO. So let me talk to, let me tell my youth friends that how did and how many times did Dr. Abdul Kalam fail? You know, Dr. Abdul Kalam was born in Rameshwaram. He used to move around the beaches and look at the birds, and always he dreamt of taking up a career in the aviation. He did succeed, but what happened is after completing his engineering, he went for an interview for Air Force, Indian Air Force, but then he did not succeed there. He stood ninth, according to his own statement. And I think 8 people got into the Indian Air Force, whereas he could not. He failed there. Subsequently, you know, he joined DRDO. He did a beautiful design to create a hovercraft, but that hovercraft never came into the practicality. There again, kind of a failure. Subsequently, he joined Indian Space Research Organization based on the request of the Vikram Sarabhai, the founder of ISRO, and MGK Menon. Here comes the turning point in the career of Abdul Kalam. His first attempt, he was the project director for a space launch vehicle, which used to be called as SLV. In 1979, when he was a project director, he tried to launch that. It failed. It went into the sea. Instead of going to space, it went into the sea. That's again a failure. But then he had mentor in the form of Professor Satish Dhawan, who said, don't worry. I mean, you failed. But there were, in fact, a lot of critics who were criticizing India that, you know, you don't have money to feed your people. That was the time when we were living from what is called as a ship-to-mouth existence. Professor Brij, Mohan, Gandhiji will understand that, you know, we had to wait for shiploads of the rice or the wheat to come from US to feed our people. But then where are we? We are here in this stage primarily because of science, technology, and research. But when we are talking about science, technology, and research, there will be a possibility of failures. And this failure, we should not be afraid of failures. And formal academy, in fact, most of the industry people have the leaders or the captains of industry have been telling to the people that the youths who are coming out, they are non-employable. Even if he could be a graduate engineer coming from the best of the colleges, but then they are not non-employable. Primary reason why they are non-employable is, like I think it was, Dr. Rashidji talked about, Abdul Rashidji talked about rote learning. You know, these people end up rote learning. They don't practice what is called as a scientific or technological method of learning. That's when they are not, they're completely afraid to take any risk. When you do when you perform an experiment, when you do any scientific or technological innovations, there is bound to be failure. There are many people who have failed. So these are some of the things. Then I will also give you, because we have less time, I will talk about one famous book that's called as a Brilliant Blunders. You know, normally the blunders and brilliant, it's kind of an oxymoron, it's an antonym. But then when such great scientists make blunders, it was called as a brilliant blunder by the author of the book, by Mr. Labio. What he says is, he talks about 5 scientists who made the greatest of blunders. Who are those scientists? One of the scientists who made that blunder by introducing what is known as a cosmological constant was Einstein himself. Einstein and making a blunder, can we ever imagine that? He did so in his general theory, general theory of relativity. So when Einstein can make a blunder, can commit a mistake, why should we be afraid of failures? After all, we are a lesser mortal in comparison with Einstein. Similarly, Charles Darwin, we all know that On the Origin of Species by Natural Selection was written by Charles Darwin. So evolution and Darwin are directly interrelated. But then he himself made a blunder. He talked about what is called as a blended inheritance. He was not aware of what is happening in the stage of genetics. He never knew about what Gregor Mendel was doing parallel. So he talked about what is called as a blended genetics, blended inheritance. That means if I have a black and a white genes, and then when they cross, what we get is only the gray. That means black is completely out. When I cross two things, the black, one generation is completely out. So this is the kind of a blunder that Charles Darwin did. Same is the case with another great man who earned actually, I think perhaps the only man who has got 2 Nobel Prizes, Linus Pauling, 2 individual Nobel Prizes. Linus Pauling got a Nobel Prize in chemistry single-handedly. Linus Pauling also got a prize in peace. What did he do? He, you know, he took almost about 13 years for publishing his triple helix model in publication. But then he was also working for finding out the structure of DNA. He wrongfully conceived that the structure of DNA could be a triple helix underneath it. So, you know, the reason I'm trying to tell you this thing, in this world of what we call as a disruptive innovation. You got to take experiment. You got to use this thing. Take the examples of people who are not formally educated, out of school, out of college people, like Microsoft Bill Gates. He was a college dropout. What about the Apple founder, Steve Jobs, a college dropout? But they all took chances. They all failed, perhaps n number of times, but finally succeeded. So with this message, what I would like to tell, and also, you know, you also get what is called as an opportunities. I will only take, I don't know how much time I have, I'll take only one more minute, to tell you about an opportunity that one of the greatest scientists of India got. That was Chandrasekhar Venkatraman. C.V. Raman got the Nobel Prize in 1930 for physics. But what was he? He was nothing but an assistant accountant general. He was working for the British government in the financial department. He was posted in Calcutta. When he was traveling to his office in Calcutta by the tram, he just saw one board. The name of the board was Indian Association for Cultivation of Science. Now, that board actually motivated the scientist hidden in Raman to become a scientist. That was such a lab that, you know, there was hardly anything. Brij Mohan Gandhiji talked about low-cost material, low-cost equipment that they have used. Or for maybe similarly, Raman used a low-cost instrument to win the Nobel Prize and talk about what is known as the Raman effect. Until that time, you know, we only knew about Lord Rayleigh, why the sky is blue, but why the ocean is blue. He talked about that and got the Nobel Prize.
Lovely, sir. Thank you.
Yeah, it was only because of the board that he saw. So in this modern youth, for all the modern youths, you have wonderful opportunities. You also have a beautiful government, a science and technology infrastructure. Please take these opportunities as you lead towards the fourth industrial revolution. Don't be afraid of failures. Experiment, and with maybe help from the Charles Waters Research and Innovation Society and several others, I'm sure you'll be able to make name not only for yourself. You will be successful not only for yourself, but also to the nation and to the humanity in general. Thank you so much for giving me an opportunity. I am ready to take questions very later on.
Absolutely, and a big round of applause. Dr. Shivprasad, I'm so amazed. The way today's children rattle off, say, a Barcelona or Manchester United lineup, the way I could see your passion from Paulus Lenning, Mendel, Darwin, Dr. Kalam, C.V. Raman. So this is the passion I'm looking at. I have a question for you, sir. And so you spoke about blunders, a lot of blunders, and you spoke about others' blunder. So besides getting married, what is the biggest blunder of your life?
Okay, since you talked about this blunder, my passion was to join the Indian Armed Forces. We had a major, unfortunately, what I had is what is called as a heart murmur, because I come from a sanic school. I could not succeed there. That was my failure, not in my hand. But then I joined the science communication, non-formal science communication, and I'm very passionate about it. I love science communication. The greatest satisfaction is when we are able to talk to the students, and out of those hundreds and thousands of people, there are four or five who passionately pursue science as a career. That is the greatest gift to us.
Wow, sir. I love the articulation. I love the clarity of thoughts. And I wish, sir, you were my science teacher. Trust me, it's amazing, sir, the way you presented. Thank you so much with folded hands, Dr. Shivprasad, here for everybody. And I think, you know, you're free to put questions in the chat boxes. Let me now, you know, take the honor to introduce yet another illustrious panelist here, Dr. Priyadarshi Nayak, founder, Global Training Institute, GTEF, Global Education and Training Institute. Thank you so much, sir, and welcome.
My sincere regards to the entire CWSIR team, who has very rightly and right time after the 1 year celebration of National Education Policy launching by Honorable Prime Minister yesterday. And absolutely, that summit was also, that a policy after completion was also meant for the youth. I must congratulate CWSIR for organizing this World Youth Summit. And I can say, I'm so proud to hear the eminent speakers, like, you know, Shivprasadji was really wonderful. You know, when I talk to anybody, you know, I am in the field of education. I'm a school leader. Of course, I'm leading or dealing with a lot of youth in the days. So a personal and professional development, what Major Harsh Kumar said, or Dr. Abdullah Raseed, the education minister, has said, very rightly said, and they were into the field of education. I would also talk about the areas where school educators or the youth, those who are turning up, those who are coming into the field of education, that matters. That I'll be speaking to all of you. Professional and personal development is something through which the organization and individual engage in the process of learning to meet a lot of challenges and to meet the desired goal. Friends, becoming the first version of yourself is my first point. What it means, we need to develop talents and potential, build human capital, and facilitate employability into it. What I mean to say that becoming the best person for yourself, this is my first point of personal development. Let go of limiting beliefs. We need to amplify our strengths.
You know,
every personal development need to develop growth mindset. Everyone need to throw out expectations. By willing to shed your old identity, we need to find out our work. So we need all individuals, it may be a teacher, an educator, a youth, you need to prioritize your outcomes. If at all you prioritize your outcomes, I believe everything can be possible, you know, in your faith. Create empowering rituals. Have compassion for yourself. This is something which I mean to say, that you need to become the best version of yourself. The second thing which I want to say is developing an open mindset as opposed to a closed mind. All educators, my message to all of you, those with an open mindset seek after truth. Even if it means changing their mind, those with a closed mindset seek to be right. So those with open mindset have a genuine fear of missing important information and are thus hungry to learn and seek others' perspective. Those with a closed mindset have no desire to learn or seek others' perspectives. So those with open mindset are able to be very objective about themselves and their knowledge, and admit what they do not know. So those with a closed mindset are always emotionally attached to their knowledge and have a hard time disconnecting from themselves. Even if everyone might be knowing about Stephen Covey's 7 Habits of Successful People, we all need to know. And I want every youth should be, you know, they need to be proactive. You know, there are 7 habits of Stephen Covey, and everyone, I believe, every youth must have, every youth educator must have. One is be proactive. The second one, begin with the end in mind. That should be in the mind. Put first things first. If that has been done, I think you will achieve your goal. Think always win-win. Never think, you know, okay, I may not be able to do it. Always you think win-win. Seek first to understand, then to be understood. If that is the, you know, this is what, you know, Stephen Covey's 7 successful stories. You need to synergize. You need to sharpen the saw. So these are the 7 things which I think very rightly, you know, a personal development is required when we talk about Stephen Covey's habits. Let me go for the next one. This, which I believe is better time management. Everyone knows, every educator, every leader, set your goals correctly. Prioritize wisely, set a time limit to complete your task. It may be a school leader, it may be an educator, it may be a teacher. If at all you can organize yourself, you will have your personal development. Remove all non-essential tasks or activities which is to be there. You need to plan out, you need to prioritize, you need to plan out your work. So if that has been done, I think this is the best way where you can plan out, appreciate the value of time. The next one which I need to say that is the pursuit of excellence. The pursuit of excellence is an unending pursuit. Our goal is to exceed our clients' expectations or our parents' expectations and our own also. And set the bar higher and do it all again. Friends, we always want to strive for excellence. The pursuit of excellence means we are always looking for better ways to perfect our work and its outcome. So this is what I believe a youth personal development must be there. And the last one for the personal development is anticipating future opportunities, anticipating future needs. You know, forecasting is used to access the past tricks. So this is what I mean, the professional development. I started with personal development, which an educator must have is, you know, to have a foresight behind it. When you have a foresight, evaluate anticipate future opportunities, I think you need to, you will develop a perfect plan for your future. That is professional development. When you talk about, you know, the next one can be being creative. As more and more activities get automated, humans need to be more creative. Human needs to be more innovative. And humans need to be empathetic. This is my thinking, if at all you want to, if every youth want to develop professionally. Empathy begins with attention. I always say, creativity does it also creativity does. In both the cases, you pay attention to everything. You know, your creativity, your innovative things will certainly play and improve your professional development. Opportunities, the next one. What are the, you know, in professional development, we have a lot of roles. It may be in the field of cybersecurity or in cyber safety. There are types of roles you need to specialize onto it. My last and foremost thing is the artificial intelligence professional development. Every professional teacher, educator, now then should know about the working of artificial intelligence. The importance of artificial intelligence and machine learning has been increasing, or you can say as a growing number. Every companies are now coming up with technologies. So we educators also need to understand. All educators are now converted to a transformed educator with the techno savvy matters. So these products also is going to give us, you know, different business modules and enhance the decision-making process. Why artificial intelligence and machine learning? Because it is going to enhance the decision-making process. So friends, with the more than a narrow specialist, I believe professionally, if you want to grow, then you need to follow all these points. And I think, so keep learning a range of variety of things, which you need to continue to learn and learn and relearn for the future aspect. My message to all the youth teachers, educators all around, that school educators, school leaders must grow professionally and personally, hand to hand, to pursue it. Thank you very much. Namaskar.
Thank you so much, Dr. Priyadarshini. Such an enlightening, so crisp and precise. And sir, as always, we've created a tradition. A quick question to you, sir. You know, so many things that you mentioned about, if there was one subject we could introduce in the schools today and you could do that, which one would be, sir? Very precise, as always. What would that be, sir?
Fantastic. You know, everywhere, everything is happening. But, you know, now as this is a technology world or digital learning is happening, digital education is happening. If at all given a chance, I would love to have an AI lab in my school. Artificial intelligence, I believe it is something fantastic is happening. And every teacher, every learner need to know it. And I think Dr. Dhiraj is over here. He will agree with this. And he is a techno man. And I believe, you know, in these days, when technology, everyone is adopting, everyone is doing it. So now there is no way when you go with blended learning and all. So I want, if these labs are set up in schools, not only in my school and all over India, I think children will be the future citizen of this.
Wonderful, sir. Wonderful. So much of transparency, so much of thought that went into what you said. Thank you so much with folded hand. That was Dr. Priyadarshini. Wonderful.
My regards.
Now, let's hop continents now and time zones, and somebody who's been almost so awake, you know, as we are almost coming to the end of dawn and dusk here, Dr. Aijaz Qureshi, all the way from Canada, President Dream TV. Sir, welcome so much to this panel and thank you so much for being here.
Thank you so much, Dr. Dawood, Waid, and respected speakers. It's an honor and privilege to be speaking beside all learned people here. Thank you so much, CWSIR, for giving me the opportunity to speak on the Youth World Summit 2021. I really appreciate it. My topic of the day is advocating young people's needs past COVID-19. We all are going through difficult times, and we all have seen the bad and the worst of the COVID-19. But again, what is the plan to go forward? What are the needs that youth specifically and this entire subcontinent, India and Pakistan, has most of the youth between 18 to 25 years old, and we need to really see what they need post COVID-19. The impact, we all know the impact of COVID-19 on young people and other vulnerable groups have been really drastic. And people have faced and shared their concerns about mental health. That's number one, actually, because everybody is mentally upset. Some people have lost their loved ones. Some people have their loved ones in this COVID-19 situation that they are either suffering or recovering or what have you. And some people have lost actually the employment. Some people have lost their disposable income that they were making from different ways. And the foremost thing that has been impacted was the education, actually. The education was disrupted because not all the institutions were internet ready. So they had to adopt quickly in order to cope with the COVID-19 situation. The impact on the young people have various factors and aspects, and our youth need to have proper health conditions and health facilities. They are looking for safety after post COVID-19 because of the stereotypes and things like that. If somebody had gone through COVID-19, the society has difficulty accepting and moving with that person. Unfortunately, although that person has recovered from that disease, but is still that person, according to my experience and the people who I talked to, said that they have difficulty merging back into the society. Employment issues will be there. Again, healthy environment should be provided to them. Education should continue to be at the same level as pre-COVID-19. Food security and good nutrition is a must to have because lots of things have been impacted. The productions and the crop has been impacted because of the COVID-19, and participation and inclusion is a must. Again, I would reemphasize this, that participation and inclusion of everyone, regardless of their COVID, they had COVID or not, that's a must. And then again, peace and security. That is really important because we see that lots of things are not going the right way, the way they should have been gone. Now the government is supporting and they're responding back to build back a better country for everyone to live and survive. And they are delivering to all the generations, but specifically the governments are working towards facilitating the young people. And we should have trust. All the youth should have trust in governments and their responses to the pandemic. That is really, really important. Youth is a catalyst, I consider, to be inclusive and resilient for societies. That's very important. And youth organizations, there are tons of youth organizations in India and Pakistan that they are playing their role in mitigating and disrupting the crisis and dealing with the crisis.
Right.
Thank you so much. Engaging youth is very, very important to my knowledge, and we have to really include all the youth and their participation. We have to build their trust. We have to have a long-term commitment with them. And no non-young people should be left behind. So thank you so much for giving me.
Wonderful. And thank you so much, sir. A round of applause for Dr. Aijaz. You can use your emoticons. We are talking about youth, so let's feel a little young and let's use a lot of emotions out there. Dr. Aijaz, very quickly, you spoke about the youth. You are founder of Dream TV. 2050, sir, what do you see the youth contributing to the world?
2050. I'm not sure if I will be there or not, but
God bless you with long life and good health, sir.
thank you. I see the youth of the subcontinent and taking a leading role into everywhere, into science and technology, into politics, into business and marketing, into education and everything. And I see that they will do a lot better than what we did and our past generations did. Why? Because they have access to every information and every single detail that is related to these fields. So thank you so much.
Wonderful, and thank you so much, sir. So I mean, the future is bright and hopeful, as Dr. Aijaz says. I wish Absolutely. The same, and thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Let's again go island hopping as we go to our next speaker all the way from Philippines, Donisa Arbas, ma'am, co-founder Nexa Doors. Thank you so much, one of the first panelists to come in. Cheerful and welcome, ma'am. So glad to have you here. Right, Donisa, ma'am. Please, you can unmute yourself and we can speak up.
Thanks, Dr. Dawood, for the very warm welcome.
You're welcome, ma'am.
It is not a searcher for consensus, but a molder of consensus. Distinguished guests, fellow speakers, organizers, ladies and gentlemen, good evening. These powerful words by Martin Luther the King reminds me of a young girl from Dumaguete City, Philippines, who experienced bullying and rejection from her classmates and friends since elementary until university years. Not because she was physically weak or intellectually challenged, but because of her refusal to follow bandwagon, apathy, and egocentrism. Despite the financial challenges she faced back then, she's one proof that socioeconomic status is not a hindrance to dream, inspire, and influence. Currently based in Dubai, working as a governess, educator, parenting coach, and a co-founder of Nexados, which is an online platform for contribution and learning, I would like to express my heartfelt gratitude to one great leader, Dr. Abhishek Pandey, founder and president of WSIR, whose vision to empower the youth has provided us the opportunity to speak from our own experience the importance of making a difference on a greater scale. Why are we placing the young people at the center of COVID recovery? One reason being young people are three times as likely as adults over 25 to be unemployed. Nearly 19 months since COVID upturned the global economic trajectory, countries are gradually progressing towards recovery and companies are restructuring their organizational systems. With this, the young people may find themselves unprepared for the new order and the changing economy. For this reason, we, the older generation, are faced with a challenge: better equip the youth in their professional and personal dimension so they will have the capacity and ability to provide bespoke sustainable solutions addressing the need of the current time as well as the generation to come. Let me give you my humble opinion on how we can work on that in a nutshell. Just remember these four points: reskill, renew, responsibility, and relevance. Let's talk about the first point, reskill. In a survey conducted by the McKinsey Global Institute in 2017, an estimated 14% of the global workforce will need to be reskilled entirely, while 40% would require partial reskilling to continue in their current occupations, and 70% in the executive levels. The Institute identified four key skills which are critical for these workers in the COVID-19 recovery. First, the ability to operate in a fully digital environment. Second, cultivating cognitive skills for redesign and innovation. Third, reinforcing social and emotional skills for greater collaboration, management, and self-expression. And fourth, cultivating resilience and adaptiveness to be able to endure expected COVID-19 aftershocks. On a similar vein, the youth need to develop both technical and soft skills, be it in a formal or non-formal setting. It is high time that policymakers and curriculum developers update school curricula to better prepare the young generation for future work. The youth who are listening to this speech, it's time that you start asking these questions to yourselves. Do I have the skills that match with the demand in the market? Have I strengthened my social skills? Do I have the emotional intelligence and agility to handle various crises? What preparations have I done to face the post-COVID world? The second point, renew. Fine-tuning our internal monologue is vital in shaping our lives. We have heard of the difference between a fixed mindset and a growth mindset, a victim mentality and a victor mentality. All of us face giants and storms in various forms, but how we deal with them and what we have become out of them reflect the kind of mindset that we hold. I grew up hearing people telling me I was different, that I was nothing, that I'm not good, that I don't belong. I remembered when I was in university, my classmates would not invite me during lunch break, either because I didn't have the money to treat them, or I didn't wear fashionable clothes that would please them. However, I did not allow my unpleasant circumstance to define me. I am who I am because God loves me and He has blessed me with things even beyond my naked eyes can see. There is more to life than this. These were the words I would always tell myself. For the benefit of those who are not familiar with the difference between a fixed mindset and a growth mindset, the former believes that your qualities are carved in stone and it creates an urgency to prove yourself over and over. If you have only a certain amount of intelligence, a certain personality, a certain moral character, well, then you'd better prove that you have a healthy dose of them. It simply wouldn't do to look or feel deficient in though in these most basic characteristics. However, the growth mindset is based on the belief that your basic qualities are things you can cultivate through your efforts. Although people may differ in every which way, in their initial talents and aptitudes, interests or temperaments, everyone can change and grow through application and experience. The third point, responsibility. Leadership is about taking responsibility. Leadership and responsibility are two big concepts, but I would like to highlight this one in the context of leading oneself and taking responsibility of one's own growth and happiness. To the young people who are listening to me live or to those who will watch this recording, I would like to emphasize that you are the co-creator of who you want to be and where you want to be in life. Do not wait what the government can do for you, nor wait for the circumstance to get better because life is not perfect and never will. Do not wait for anyone to tell you to rise and walk. Be your own cheerleader and fan. If you want to impact lives, start from yourself and let the others see you transform. The world is your audience and it is looking for fruits, for results, and not mere words. Oh, yesterday, wonderful. Mr. Edward Gonzalez from NASA pointed out that your network is your net worth. Start evaluating what kind of connection you have. Miss Yolanda Peterson from South Africa mentioned about goal setting and visualizing. In case you haven't done this, then start. Time is of the essence. Become a responsible leader. You first need to evaluate the types of questions you're asking yourself regarding your daily life. If you can identify habits and thought processes that serve as barriers to responsible leadership, you stand a good chance of being able to make a positive change. The fourth point, relevance. As we continue to inspire the youth, thrive in their chosen field of expertise and not only survive, I would like to remind the young generation of Denzel Washington's words of wisdom. Don't just aspire to make a living, aspire to make a difference. You are the future doctors, entrepreneurs, educators, lawyers, nurses, IT experts, and so on, future engineers. You are there for a purpose. But besides fulfilling the aspire to be a person of great value that your absence will be felt because of how you have touched people's lives. You've influenced them to become better individuals. Above all, you are the future fathers and mothers of the next generation. You hold in your hand the power to nurture a generation into excellence in every aspect of their lives through your example.
Arbaz ma'am, can I intervene and just ask you a question? I'm so glad. You spoke about relevance. You want to finish up. Please go ahead.
Because I'm almost done.
Yes.
Leadership starts at home, in your family. And we know that family is the basic unit of society. As we pass the baton of legacy to you, may you continue the run to run the race of life with so much fire, determination, and perseverance to live exemplary lives which we, the older generation, can be proud to witness, and one in which your children and your children's children will be proud to live.
Thank you so much, and absolutely, you know, this is the toughest job of being a moderator, where there's so much inspiring speech. You know, Arbaz ma'am, you started with Martin Luther King, and I almost felt that I'm listening to another one in the making. So thank you so much for the wise words of wisdom and the amazing analogy of leaders in a community. I think CWSIR is very biased towards islands, because we started in Maldives, we write in Philippines, and now I'll get my another guest from Sri Lanka. I think what a privilege to have these island nations come in and speak to us. Can I invite Dr. Fehmida Mohammed, an entrepreneur all the way from Sri Lanka, one of the nicest people. Despite losing to them the ODI series, I still feel one of the best people in the world and the most politest are Sri Lankans. Welcome and thank you so much for being here, ma'am.
Hello, thank you so much for that. Do pardon my very dark background. I'm unable to do anything about it, on my way from another meeting. So I'm very sorry. And at the same time, thank you so much for this wonderful opportunity. I feel honored to be amidst eminent speakers, luminaries and dignitaries who have placed forth such illuminating thoughts. It was indeed a pleasure, and it was quite enlightening to myself as how I need to be perceiving the development of youth. And I completely agree with how the last speaker, Ms. Donessa, ended. Leadership begins at home. And that's my topic, advocating the needs of youth in a post COVID-19 world. Absolutely, as many people or many speakers, many panelists have clearly stated, skills, competencies have started playing a pivotal role in the development of the youth. And what do youth stand for? Who do youth represent? The youth represent the nature, the nation. And they would be the future leaders who would be taking up lead roles and would be leading this entire nation in time to come. And they need to be nurtured in the right way. I believe that if we are able to lead them with excellence, they would be able to lead the nation with excellence. So, however, as Ms. Donessa said, the renewing, the reskilling, the relevance, all begins at home. And I've believed that there is a particular model that plays a vital role in helping youth developing themselves. Because when you see, youth are the fruits that bear from home, and leadership learning begins from home once again. So when we look into this how and the why factor, when the what has been already figured, the how is how we help them perceive the world, how we help them perceive themselves, how we help them perceive others. The bigger model comes into play. The bigger being, we need to help youth understand belongingness of themselves, belongingness of tasks, belongingness of their lives, belongingness of jobs, and all responsibilities. I provide them with the right kind of independence while guiding and supporting them. The G is to help them being generous. That is something that has come up very important, has placed a paramount importance post-COVID. And another G being the growth-oriented perception that we need to instill in them. And E is to be empowered and help them empower others. And finally, the R, responsibility, that how to take accountability of oneself, how to take accountability as a leader for their own team. Thus, the bigger model, to lead and perceive the world in a bigger way. When you look at youth, they become these fruits, the seeds that is being sowed in the hands of parents, teachers, families, friends. And the way we nurture them is what they grow into. They are being, they kind of tend to live around the cultures, the traditions, the beliefs, the values that we instill in them. It is us who are at the giving point, and youth have always been at the receiving point. What we give, they take, they learn, and they start following our path. For example, a mother and a leader are leaders in their own terms, where they inspire children, and that is where they draw their inspiration, they draw their values, they draw their life models. Hence, it is important for us to teach children of basic, beginning from basic human values to important life competencies and skills. The term unemployment has been lingering around the world for a very long time. And why does unemployment occur? It is because competencies and skills that are being sought after in every job are not available. Every human being is born with a purpose, and their purpose is to add a significant value in their own unique ways. If everybody is able to do the same thing, it's called replication. And through the theories, through the exams, through the grades that we've been defined for many centuries ago, till a few years back, nothing but the same thing has been taught to us. And we go with filled with theories, filled with good grades. And when we enter into the real world, we are competition, we are analytical skills, we are evaluation skills, where the real test lies, many tend to fail because this component of significant contribution is severely missing. In order for us to advocate their needs, we need to see them and we need to let them tread on the right path. A leader is not a person who travels on the same path for the very reason that everybody does. A leader finds a new way, paves a way, and leave the trial if it is the right way for many others to follow.
Wonderful, Dr. Samida. I just want to add something that you already said so beautifully. A leader is someone who not only knows the way, he shows the way and goes the way. And I think, you know, Dr. Samida is the leader because she's actually treading on a path. You know, she's multitasking. She's a leader on the move, a person who's actually in a hurry to change the world. God bless you and thank you so much. I'm amazed at, you know, I just hope someone who's driving is concentrating and not listening to you. I want someone to be safe, right? Because you're very powerful words. This is so wonderful, and both of you, you know, amazing ladies out there, Danesa ma'am and you, Dr. Femida, you changed the entire dynamics of letters. You spoke about something so well. You know, I recall a very nice incident. Somebody told me, when you are down, three people or three kind of things that saves you: faith, friends, or fool. Or, you know, I call it father-in-law, because father-in-law was fool to believe in me, but the same thing. But, you know, what I learned from all of you is, be strong in your faith, don't give up hope on, and then you surround your children with light prayers. I can see the mentors like you doing amazing work. I'll bring in, you know, in the end, to all these August panelists to, you know, have one quick question if anyone has it. But let me quickly call the last speaker for the day, all the way again from Thailand. David was very patient and I love the t-shirts wearing. I told he already makes me feel old. Please welcome David Perodin, the educator from Thailand. Yeah, David, I can see that. Thank you.
Hello, my friends. Yeah, it was... It was mentioned to me that I should promote my university, so here I am. I am wearing a polo shirt with the logo of my university, and I'm proudly wearing the polo shirt. I would like to quickly share my screen, and I just like most Americans, I am very time conscious, so I have my timer going. Dawood, you will not have to stop me, my friend.
That's wonderful, sir. Okay, one less work to do.
Yes. Okay. I was asked to speak about contributing to personal and professional development of young people. Fortunately for me, a couple of weeks ago, I was able to give a presentation about Generation X. And in doing so, I had to do some research to prepare for that presentation, and which that research coupled with a few interviews I did following that presentation led me to today. Now, this is me. I've been in Southeast Asia for a very long time, very, very long time. And most of my research, most of my social capital, social science and social studies based researches are done about education in Southeast Asia. And we know education in Southeast Asia tends to be a bit authoritative. And with teachers and educators who tend to be a very authoritative, they tend to want students to learn the way that they learned, in which if we limit a child to the way that we learn, we are doing a great disservice because they were born in another time. Can you imagine myself trying to educate a Generation Z-er in the way that I learned, 30 or 40 years ago? See, what I see with Generation Xers and even Generation Yers is that from this area, from the Southeast Asian area, is that they are great test takers, wonderful test takers, but they have very little real world skills. And we right now are teaching the Generation Z, and they're different. They hate lectures. My goodness, they fall asleep if someone yammers and just talks for 3 hours. And I tell my students, look, I'm not here to teach you. I'm here to help you find knowledge and find information. I try to be more of a facilitator and a role model. I tell my students that they not only need knowledge, but they need soft skills and hard skills, and they need a different disposition and the character that will make them successful in a global economy. And like other speakers who mentioned this earlier, they mentioned hard skills and soft skills. Well, my forte is language. I teach language. I teach everything about language and applied linguistics. But I also help my students with soft skills. Time management is so important. You respect my time, I will respect you. Teamwork, leadership, soft skills are very important because most countries are facing a lack of skilled workers, and there are very good jobs out there, but these young people are not ready to face these jobs unless we help prepare them. And see, as the global employment setting changes, there are certain skills that are needed for career and life success. And the Generation Zers, they learn differently. They have to be prepared differently to lead the new world. And I strongly suggest project-based learning. I really do. I use project-based learning in most of my classrooms. It's like I said before, Generation Zers, they don't want to sit there for lectures and a teacher just talking all of the time. They want to do something. They want to apply knowledge that they gain on their own. I help facilitate, but my goodness, no teacher is any match for the internet to provide knowledge. And when a teacher says, I provide knowledge, okay, you provide information. You provide some experience, but you mostly provide information. Students can get all the knowledge they want from the internet. Just ask Siri or Google. See, project-based learning is so important, in my opinion. It is an instructional method. That's where we come in. we instruct students on how to overcome, how to be triumphant with complex tasks. And the students, they have to ask questions and their problems come up. And just like the speaker said before me, these students, they need problem solving and decision making and investigative skills, and they need to be able to reflect. And if we help facilitate these things, if we help students feel comfortable about themselves, if we create positive, neutral to positive environments, and if we remove those negative environments from our classrooms, and we create a sense of success and accomplishment within our students, they will transfer that feeling of success to the real world. See, that is where project-based learning comes in. So if we want to support the youth, we need to promote practices, we need to promote new learning habits, and we need to emphasize critical thinking skills, because our students, they will discover a world that might not be what they think it is. Because my generation and the generation before me, we kind of messed up the earth, you know, and now Generation Z, okay, I'm sorry what I just said, but it's true, okay? My generation and the generation before me, we really made the earth almost inhospitable, you know? And Generation Z, they have to fix our problems. So we have to help them. We have to prepare them. And you know, the best teachers are those who show you where to look, and they don't tell you what to see. And I feel that is my job as an educator. I know that the world needs to be better. I know that people need to care about each other. And I know that instead of hating me because I'm a different skin color, or hating me because I'm a different religion, or hating me because I am not the gender, or I'm not the whatever. Why not help our young people come together, globally come together? And sometimes we have to be that role model, and we have to lead the young people. So I am completely, completely flabbergasted at the speakers who came before me. And I feel so inadequate bringing up the end of this presentation. And I hope I did well in your eyes. Thank you.
Thank you, David. Thank you so much. I think all of you gave your best, and all of you created so much better. I'm reading the feeds on Life FB, and I'm seeing people sharing love, appreciation, because at the end of the day, it's educators who have made a big difference in their life. You know, the children that we're talking about, and let me indulge as a moderator, it's the only time, you know, you can take the reins and speak for a couple of minutes. I think all of you did raise upon this particular thing. There is no planet B, so we are not looking at plan B. This is the only planet we have to live in. We, you know, of course, some of us can go and attach zero gravity and come back, but you need to be Virgin Galactic and Virgin Blue Origins. Otherwise, all of us are here. So let's work to this SDG goals. David, you spoke about the PBL and so beautifully. I want to just share a couple of things, the two slides. Children that I work with, education is incomplete without students. We did a PBL with the Euro Cup was going on and the Copa America was going on, and students had to choose a country, look at the culture. It could be Italians, it could be English, the Spanish, or the Argentinians. And then they realized that this is what we are talking about. A world where we are together, a flat world that we're together. And this is something I want to so proudly say, that idea is to write down. I wrote this book called The Four Books. Together makes the whole globe. And I think I indulge enough of myself. All of you have contributed so much and shared so wonderful evening. It made my day. And I think what better than inviting the secretary and the honorary director, Dr. Dheeraj Mehrotra, the author, president awardee of CWSIR. Sir, you've been applauding, appreciating, patiently hearing, putting your comments. Please, sir, why don't you take the honor of giving a word of thanks to all our dignitaries out here. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you, Daud. It's really a great pleasure for me to be a party this evening. And I'm really appreciative of all the wonderful speakers who came out with noble issues. Let me tell you very frankly, you know, they came out with their heart, and the dynamic deliberations really brought forward much to think over, ponder over of what best we can do with our children. Well, youth development, of course, emphasizes the importance of meeting the four human needs, which talks about belonging, the mastery, the independence, and the generosity. Well, it's very clear out of listening these wonderful speakers tonight, this evening, it's clear that the needs are going to be met in the positive ways, of course, with our supervision, support, collaboration, creative potentials being paved further. And as a result, we need to look forward to delivering these opportunities to our kids against all odds of that of Corona pandemic and all that which is around us. For sure, we are looking forward to the guidance, the approach, and the social emotional thinking is what a priority today. So we are going to also nurture with the march of time, talk to them, give them a patient hearing, as well as talk about the SEL, the social emotional intelligence, need to be given a preface at this very stroke. Managing the pressure, teaching them how to be prepared for the, you know, uncertain culture, uncertain environment, the VUCA world of volatile uncertainty all around. And that is what is going to be probably the very responsibility of we, the educators, guiding them. Of course, they are well versed about what's going on around, and also to the very, very spectrum of not treating them as kids, but young adults. And technology has made them beforehand. And that certainly comes out to the paging. So I'm really excited to deliver a vote of thanks first to Dr. Shruti Marawa, the General Secretary, our founder president, Dr. Pandey, who has been taking this initiative, connecting all of us, our speakers for today. We started with Dr. Abdullah Raseed, the Honorable Minister of State Education from Maldives. Thank you so very much, sir. Then we had a wonderful speech on World as a Family by Major Harsh Kumar, the Secretary of the NCERT. And this gentleman really, really brought forward from heart. So thank you so very much, sir, for your wonderful deliberation. Then we had Dr. Brij, Gandhi, the former advisor, Ministry of Science and Technology. Thank you so very much, sir. You spoke from the heart and we could make out how the intelligent mind works. And then we had the wonderful speech by Dr. Shivprasad, who the former director, Nehru San Center, Maharashtra. Sir, you really brought forward the wonderful story of my mentor. Of course, I've been, you know, honored by this gentleman. I do remember his words. Dr. Kalam, who talked about, and it goes to the youth of today, that having a small aim in life is the biggest crime in the world. And that is what I recall today of your speech about him. Then my friend, Dr. Priyadarshi Nayak, the founder of GTEF India, and a wonderful academician, a great committed leader of the country. Thank you very much, sir, for your deliberation. And then we have speeches by two wonderful ladies. Of course, not to forget Dr. Aijaz Qureshi, the president for Dream TV. You talked about ethics and the connect with the youth today. The speech by the wonderful lady, Donza Arbas, the co-founder for Nexados from Philippines. You really talked great sense, let me tell you. From the heart, you spoke about the youth, the empathy you mentioned, and it is a reality. It is a reality, and we need to touch upon that. And the speech by Dr. Fatima Mohammed, the entrepreneur from Sri Lanka. Well, I've been visiting Sri Lanka quite often with the Ministry of Education at the Ratnapura province. So thank you very much. You recalled of that interest. and the deliberation and the approach, you know, I could see that the challenge you received out of, you know, deliberating so well in no light, and that too in the traffic. My goodness, kudos to you, and God bless you for this. But next time when we want you to be in a proper place to listen to you the best. Of course, you deliberated one of the best sessions today. Thank you so very much. Also, finally, my friend from Thailand, David, you did it great. Not only your t-shirt is looking smart, you are also with your deliberation. So once again, I can plug on that logo of yours. Congratulations. And thank you so very much. Least, not the least, for sure, the wonderful host for the day, the moderator. Thank you so very much, Daud Bhai. God bless you. Over to you.
Right. Thank you so much, Dr. Dheeraj. And I can see the way you summarize the entire thing. So beautiful. So many takeaways. I think I just wrote down, any panelists would like to recommend any book. I think this is so wonderful. Any one book that you want to recommend, I'll open the floor for any panelists to please go ahead and suggest. I'm sure Dr. Shiva would have a list of all science books. So, you know, I'll exclude him. Right. But sir, why don't I begin with you? Any book that you like to recommend as an educator? And we'll take a minute more and then we end our session there. Tanisa, ma'am, Aijaz, sir, Brit, sir. All right, I'm beginning. Yeah, Shiva, sir, please go ahead.
Okay, man, I think I already told there, Brilliant Blunders. It's a book by Mario Livio. For those people who are afraid of failure, please read that, and you'll find that five of the topmost scientists of the world, their mistakes have been highlighted there. So next time when you, after reading that, you'll not be afraid of failures or making mistakes.
That's wonderful, sir. I think we will take that as the right end to it. Make mistakes, but make new ones. Don't be afraid. Fly high, as Samuel Brackett said so well. Faith is all about jumping from the cliff with two options. Either you know that there'll be land or you'll get wings to fly. So let's keep flying from everybody out here. Thank you so much. Have a wonderful evening and a great future for our children lies if you are the educators. Once again, I'm your host, Daud Waid, signing off. And from everybody here as Charles Water, Society of Innovation, thank you so much. Good night. Bye-bye, everybody. God bless.
Thank you, everyone. Bye.